thank you so much for coming. So it is a really true pleasure for me to introduce Natalie today as she presents her thesis work. As probably many of you know, this is an exciting day, not just for Natalie and her family. It's actually a very exciting day for me, especially exciting as she's the first graduate student to graduate from my lab, so. I wish I could take more credit for that. I think really it is Natalie's hard work, her intelligence, her perseverance, her tenacity that has brought us to this day. And it's clearly not just myself that feels that way. One can look through Natalie's achievements over the last 5 years and it's truly impressive. She has received 11 awards in just the last 5 years for her work, whether they be travel awards from prestigious societies or awards from the School of Biological Sciences, the Carl Kampmann Young Scholar Award, NSF Fellowship, list goes on and on. In addition to this, Natalie has been incredibly productive, not just in our lab, but even with her prior research. She's now published 7 manuscripts and a book chapter, and she has another couple papers in the works and review and things like that. So as impressive as this is in terms of her research, I think it's really important to point out that Natalie is not just sort of a one-trick pony. She has also been incredibly devoted to teaching and as well as outreach to the community. She's served as the lecturer and a lead TA for the neurobiology lab course. She also played an integral role in a development of a film-based flipping of that course. She's also served as a chair of REMIND, a student-run outreach organization, for the last 4 years. Clearly, I could go on and on and on, but I want to make sure that you guys have enough time to really hear about the exciting research that Natalie's been doing, some research related to Lewy body dementia and Parkinson's that have some really translational implications. So without further ado, we're going to be hearing from Natalie about disrupting these phenotypes in dementia with Lewy bodies with neural stem cell transplantation. So please help me welcome Natalie.
Transplantation as a therapeutic approach. I often open my talks with this image as a reminder that when you're studying disease, you're almost never looking at just one thing. We're usually familiar with the disease by one pathological feature or one hallmark symptom, but those are really just the tip of the iceberg, and there's a lot more going on under the surface that we often miss out on understanding. So with Lewy body dementia with Lewy bodies, that hallmark feature is the Lewy bodies themselves. And so I'm gonna talk about them today, but I'm also gonna go a little deeper and talk about some of the mechanisms that are disrupted and how to approach fixing them. So dementia with Lewy bodies is a neurodegenerative disorder that shares similarities with both Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease. And it kind of sits in the middle of the spectrum between a cognitive and a motor disorder because it has features of both. Patients have symptoms like memory loss, which is similar to dementia with Alzheimer's disease, but they also have visual hallucinations, sporadic shifts in executive function, and confusion, and they develop autonomic problems, as well as Parkinsonian motor symptoms such as tremor. So with this wide variety of symptoms that these patients are affected with, it becomes very difficult to diagnose this disorder until you look at the Lewy bodies themselves in the postmortem tissue. And the reason is because if you look at a Parkinsonian brain, you see a few Lewy bodies and a lot of midbrain dopamine cell loss. When you look at an Alzheimer's disease brain, you can see the presence of a few Lewy bodies and mostly cortical cell loss. When you look at the brain of a patient with dementia with Lewy bodies, the burden of the Lewy bodies themselves is significantly higher. And so it's easy to see the difference in how these patients are affected. They occur all over the brain, and so they affect a wide variety of systems, of neurotransmitter systems and cell systems. And some of these systems include dopamine and glutamate pathways distinctly related to motor and cognitive function, and I'll talk about both of these a lot today, actually. If you look at these Lewy bodies up close, you can see how they might be associated with trouble. Inside the cell body, this will go away, I promise. Inside the cell body, you can see that the Lewy bodies are actually this round, hyaline-looking circle with a halo around it. And these are insoluble. The cell cannot degrade them. It can't get rid of them. It's like kidney stones for a neuron. They can't get rid of them on their own. And so, although we've known about these Lewy bodies for a long time, they were first discovered in 1912 by Friedrich Levy, or Lewy, but we only recently are starting to understand how they form and how to interrupt that formation and how to get rid of them in the cell. And that's because in 1997, it was discovered that the majority of the proteins that make up these Lewy bodies are alpha-synuclein. And not much was known about alpha-synuclein at the time of this discovery, so this launched a lot of research into trying to figure out what this protein actually does in the healthy brain and what goes wrong to make it form these Lewy bodies that become so problematic. So alpha-synuclein doesn't actually just exist in one protein conformation. That would be too easy. It exists in this flux with all kinds of different ensembles or conformers of the protein that have various functions, some of them not great functions, and some of them we don't understand yet. So part of the problem in addressing this disease is trying to figure out what all of these different conformations are doing. What we do know generally about alpha-synuclein's function is that it exists, is produced very highly in neurons, and specifically at the synapses of neurons. And at those synapses, synuclein is somehow involved with regulating and maintaining a neurotransmitter vesicle pool and facilitating the binding of those vesicles with the synaptic terminal membrane and releasing neurotransmitters into the synapse so that cells can communicate with other cells. But when there's too much alpha-synuclein, these processes all become disrupted, signaling is disrupted, and other cell processes are also not impaired. So what happens is you have these aggregates of alpha-synuclein protein that occur at the synaptic terminals, but that also travel up the axon and aggregate further in the cell body into these insoluble, these massive Lewy body forms. And the presence of those Lewy bodies is affected with all kinds of downstream cell stress, like mitochondrial dysfunction, other problems with metabolism and autophagy, and general problems that keep the cells from signaling properly. So you can see there are multiple mechanisms that are really disrupted by the presence of this protein aggregation. And it's very unlikely, as I said, that we're going to fix the problem by targeting just one thing, by just targeting alpha-synuclein, by just trying to replace the dopamine that's lost. So my approach to this has been to use neural stem cells as a powerful tool that can address multiple mechanisms that are disrupted in these cells. And don't get bogged down by the details on this slide. I'm simply using it to illustrate that stem cells can help in a lot of different ways. Transplanted neural stem cell can produce growth factors or neurotrophic factors that can be released into the endogenous brain environment and affect the cells that are there. So these stem cells can affect the survival, positively affect the survival and the synapse formation in neurons. They can interact with immune cells of the brain to help how those immune cells are regulating their response to the disease and to the transplantation itself. They can stimulate neurogenesis, which is the birth of new cells to replace old dysfunctional ones. Or they can differentiate into multiple different cell types. They can become neurotransmitter-producing neurons to replace sick ones, or they can become glial cells like astrocytes and oligodendrocytes that in turn produce a very high level of neurotrophic factors, support factors, that help provide support for those neurons. So collectively, it's been shown in multiple different health and disease paradigms that stem cells can improve cognition and motor function. And it is for these reasons that I chose to focus on the ability of these stem cells to help out in dementia with Lewy bodies. And my approach to that has two parts. The first is to look at genetically similar mouse transplantation into a mouse model of dementia with Lewy bodies. And the second part begins to look at how we translate this into an eventual clinical therapy by transplanting human neural stem cells into an immune-deficient model of dementia with Lewy bodies. So I'll focus on this genetically similar transplantation first. My overarching hypothesis was pretty bold, but we went with it. It was that neural stem cell transplantation could improve behavioral impairment as well as dysregulated signaling due to alpha-synuclein accumulation. And to address this hypothesis, we needed a model. Now, alpha-synuclein produced in a mouse doesn't aggregate and form Lewy bodies in the same way that human synuclein does. So we chose a model that overexpressed the human form of the protein, which is most common to dementia with Lewy bodies, that is the wild-type form. And this expression was driven by the PDGF-beta promoter, which is neuronal-specific, and as a result of that, you see a reproducible accumulation and distribution of alpha-synuclein in the mouse brain, as you would see in a human brain. So we see things like Lewy body-like inclusions that form in the neuronal cell bodies, and also smaller aggregates of the protein that occur in neurites and synapses, just like you would see in a human patient with DLB or Parkinson's disease. And importantly, these mice also exhibit motor and cognitive impairments that are similar to what you'd see in a patient, which allows us to assess the functional outcomes of the presence of this protein and what stem cells can do to help the actual behavior in these mice. The next thing I needed was to decide on a cell to transplant into them. And as it happened, a few years before I entered the lab, Matt had just published a study showing that a certain type of neural stem cell transplanted into a model of Alzheimer's disease could improve cognition in that mouse. And the cells that he used were derived from the hippocampal cortical regions of green fluorescent protein, or GFP, expressing mice. And the utility in that is after you transplant the cells, you can easily distinguish them from the endogenous cells, which are not green, in the DLB mouse or in the Alzheimer's mouse. And these neural cells, because of the time in development at which they're derived, which is postnatal day one, can become all three neural cell types in the brain. They can become neurons, or oligodendrocytes, or astrocytes. But because of that point in development where they're derived, they prefer to become glial cells, like astrocytes and oligodendrocytes. And one of the benefits of that is they are the support cells of the brain. And so, as it happens, they produce a very high level of this particular growth factor called brain-derived neurotrophic factor, or BDNF. And I'm going to talk about BDNF a lot today, too. And the BDNF in particular was attractive to me to put into a mouse that has dementia with Lewy bodies because mounting evidence continues to show that patients with DLB have reduced levels of BDNF in their brains as well. So having chosen my model and my cells, I moved forward with an experimental design, which is pretty straightforward. I aged alpha-synuclein overexpressing mice, termed ASO mice, and their wild-type littermates to 12 months, at which point their behavioral symptoms and their accumulation of synuclein were kind of at their peak. And at that time, I transplanted these GFP-expressing mouse neural stem cells bilaterally into the striatum. The striatum is a region of the midbrain that's highly involved in both motor and cognitive behaviors. And it's also highly interconnected with other regions of the brain, such as regions of the cortex, that are important for those behaviors as well. So this was kind of our hub target region for having an effect overall in these animals. So 1 month after transplantation, I then used several behavioral tasks to assess a functional outcome. And I started by looking at motor behavior. And the first task I used is the rotor rod. For those who are not familiar, it's a horizontal rotating rod that mice run along as if it were a log on a river. And this assesses motor coordination by measuring the amount of time a mouse can run on this rod without falling off. So mice who are physically normal will be able to run on the rod for a significant amount of time, whereas mice who are motor impaired will fall off fairly quickly. And that's what we see when we look at these alpha-synuclein mice. We see that the synuclein vehicle-treated mice, which is this light green column, are not able to run on the rotor rod nearly as long as their wild-type vehicle-treated littermates. However, when we transplant neural stem cells, we see almost a full recovery of this behavior. The synuclein mice are now able to run on the rotor rod the same amount of time as wild-type mice are. And to verify this, I used another motor task, that was more specific to motor control because it looks at the number of times that a mouse misplaces its foot as it's initiating movement across a narrowing beam. So when we look at this task, we see a similar kind of result. We see that the synuclein vehicle-treated mice have many more faults while traversing the beam compared to wild-type mice. But when we transplant neural stem cells, those faults are reduced back down to wild-type levels. So neural stem cells seem to be a very effective treatment for alleviating the motor deficits as assessed by these tasks, which importantly are regarded as striatal-dependent tasks. So we went on to look at cognitive behavior, and importantly, we chose our cognitive tasks very carefully because, as I've just shown you, these mice have motor impairments, and so we can't throw them into a cognitive task that depends on motor function, such as the Morris water maze, because that would convolute our interpretation of the cognitive performance. So we chose tasks that relied only on the ability of the mouse to explore a chamber. And before we ran these tasks, we verified that alpha-synuclein and wild-type mice indeed spent the same amount of time exploring this area and the objects in it, as well as had similar overall activity levels. So feeling good about these two tasks, we moved forward. And the first one that we chose, these were also really nice tasks because they are specific to certain brain regions. As I said, the striatum is highly interconnected with other regions of the brain. This first cognitive task looks at spatial memory, which is involved in hippocampal signaling, not only with the striatum, but with other brain regions as well. So in this task, mice are trained with two identical objects, and 24 hours later, one of those objects is moved to a novel location. And the utility of this task depends on the innate preference in mice to explore something new over something that's familiar. So mice with intact memories will discriminate between novel and familiar placement and spend more time investigating this object, whereas mice with poor memories for the original objects and their placements will not discriminate between these two. And that's exactly what we saw in our alpha-synuclein mice. We saw that while wild types spent a substantial amount of time investigating the novel location of the objects, alpha-synuclein mice did not discriminate between those two locations. However, if we transplanted neural stem cells, synuclein mice spent much more time investigating the novel object, indicating that they retained a memory for the familiar object and were more interested in this novel location. A complementary task is the object recognition task, which is more dependent on connections with the cortex. And in this task is very similar, except for that after training with two identical objects, you now replace one of the objects with a totally different one. And what we see in this task is exactly the same, which I was actually surprised by. We see no discrimination between novel and familiar object in synuclein mice compared to wild types, but when we transplant neural stem cells, we see a significant recovery of this behavior. So stem cells also are having the ability to rescue these two different cognitive tasks that depend on the ability of the striatum to interact with other systems in the brain. And there is some basis for this, which is that, as I mentioned, the cortex has connections with the striatum, and these connections could explain what's happening in this more cortical-dependent recognition task. What's happening with the hippocampal-based task is a little bit more hazy. There are connections between the striatum and the hippocampus. There are also connections between other regions of the midbrain and the hippocampus, so it's not inconceivable that there would be an effect of striatally transplanted cells on this hippocampal task, but it's kind of blurry. So this provides the basis of an explanation or the beginnings of it, but it's still kind of unclear as to exactly what's happening there. To figure out how these stem cells were actually affecting behavior, we needed to look at what they were doing in the brain, starting with survival. And we see this is a coronal section of a half striatum, and we see that after 1 month, the cells migrate pretty well throughout the entire region. This green line shows the injection tract and the two bolus areas where I injected the cells to facilitate a wider spread of migration. And so after 1 month, they clearly migrated far away from that injection site and survived well. And we also saw that when I looked at the early neuronal marker, double cortin, only a small percentage of these cells expressed this marker, which is kind of what we expected. But they also express high levels of the glial markers GFAP and Olin2, indicating that just as we had hoped, because mast cells had done this, these stem cells preferentially become glial cells, not neuronal cells, which is great, because that's what I was hoping they would do. So then what are these cells doing actually in the brain? The first thing you want to ask is whether they're affecting the star pathology, the alpha-synuclein. So I started to look at alpha-synuclein by looking at the Lewy body-like inclusions in the brain. And what I saw when I counted these total numbers in vehicle and cell-treated synuclein mice is that the cells did not seem to have an impact. There was no difference in the number of inclusions in the brain. So okay, the stem cells aren't affecting this particular form of alpha-synuclein, because as I said, there are other forms of this protein. So I went on to look by I went on to look by Western blot at the microdissected striatum at the total protein levels, starting with the monomer. of this human alpha synuclein, which, as I said, is the synuclein that aggregates in the brain. And what I saw by Western blot is there was also no difference in expression levels between cell-treated and vehicle-treated synuclein mice. And I verified this in several other regions of the brain, which I also mentioned are connected with the striatum. So stem cells are not having an effect on the monomeric human alpha synuclein, and they're not having an effect on these Lewy body-like inclusions. But somehow they're affecting behavior. So I spoke about those other mechanisms before that might be affected. What's going on with them? I mentioned specifically that DLB patients have reduced BDNF in their brains. And so I looked at BDNF in our alpha-synuclein mice and found that that was the case with them as well. Alpha-synuclein mice have a 50% reduction of BDNF protein in their striatum. However, transplanted stem cells elevate that BDNF level back to wild-type levels, which is very exciting. This is the biggest impact that I had seen in these mice so far in the brain. Now, BDNF is part of a kinase signaling pathway that involves the ERK kinases 1 and 2, and the transcription factor ELF1, both of which are important to promoting transcription of genes that are responsible for regulating the growth and the survival of these cells. So I looked at the phosphoepitopes of these proteins and found that while there was not a reduction of ERK2 or ERK1 and 2 or ELF1 in the synuclein mice compared to wild types, there was a significant elevation of their expression with stem cell transplantation. So what this suggests is that stem cells may have an overall beneficial effect on this pathway, but there may also be other kinase pathways involved that are specific to what's happening in alpha-synuclein mice. So I also mentioned that there are reductions in dopamine signaling and glutamate signaling in patients with DLB, and so I went on to look at those in the brain as well. However, you can't easily look at dopamine and glutamate by Western blot, because they're not proteins. But you can look at the enzymes that produce them, the transporters that are responsible for regulating them. So with dopamine, I looked at phosphoepitopes of the enzyme tyrosine hydroxylase, which is responsible for synthesizing dopamine. And when I looked at a few of those phosphoepitopes, I saw a modest but significant reduction in their expression in synuclein vehicle mice that was elevated by the neural stem cells. So the cells are having an impact on improving the synthesis of dopamine. When I looked at glutamate, I'm going to show you two of the very significant transporters. First, VGlut1, which is specific to glutamate that comes to the striatum through the cortex. So again, implicating this cortical striatal pathway that may explain the cell's ability to improve our cortical-based cognitive behavior. Because when I look at VGlut1 protein expression, there's a reduction in synuclein mice that's again elevated by the neural stem cells. I also looked at a glial-specific glutamate transporter, GLT1, and saw something very similar, a reduction in the synuclein mice that was significantly elevated by the stem cells. So now we have sort of a mechanism by which stem cells could be improving these behaviors by improving regulation of dopamine and glutamate signaling. But if we refer back to this schematic, I showed you that BDNF has an influence on ERK kinases and ELF1. But it turns out that dopamine and glutamate, through their receptors, activate these pathways as well. So now we need to find out how these three proteins are related and if their expression is affecting one another. So the question is, are dopamine and glutamate signaling up or downstream of what's happening with BDNF? And the first thing that I did to address this question was to take the BDNF away, at least from the stem cells. So in our lab, we developed an shRNA knockdown of BDNF in these GFP mouse neural stem cells. And before transplantation, I verified in these BDNF knockdown cells, hereafter BKCs, that there is an at least 84% knockdown of BDNF. However, importantly, that does not affect the multipotency of these cells because they still express high levels of factors like SOX2 and MUSASHI1, which are important to characterize the ability of the stem cells to then differentiate into other cells. And then I also confirmed that in vivo, after transplantation, these BDNF knockdown cells do not acquire the ability to express BDNF as their parent cells do. So feeling okay about the cells, I then transplanted them in a similar paradigm to what I've shown you before. Transplanted in mice of 12 months age and then looked at behavior 1 month later and compared the effects of these GFP cells or the BDNF knockdown cells. So I began again with our motor tests. And what I saw on rotarod was once again deficits in synuclein vehicle mice that were elevated by stem cells. However, those deficits were not recovered if I transplanted BDNF knockdown cells. And similarly, in our beam traversal challenge, foot faults in traversing the beam were reduced by neural stem cells, but not by BDNF knockdown cells. And this is a pretty clear distinction that these cells are just not helping very much at all. And that was the case with these two cognitive tasks as well. Synuclein mice, again, did not discriminate between novel, familiar placement or object, and they did not do so with the BDNF knockdown transplants either. So stem cell-derived BDNF also seems to be critical for improving these behaviors. When I looked at the microdissected striatal protein, I once again saw a reduction in total mature BDNF that was elevated by the neural stem cells, but not by the BDNF knockdown cells. And similarly, when I looked at our phosphoepitope for tyrosine hydroxylase, BDNF knockdown cells don't elevate that either. And finally, they also don't improve the levels of GLT-1, that glutamate transporter. So if there's not BDNF in these stem cells, they don't rescue behavior, they don't seem to elevate BDNF in the brain, they don't help with dopamine and glutamate signaling either. So the answer appears to be yes, dopamine and glutamate signaling are downstream of BDNF. Because if BDNF isn't elevated, these proteins are not elevated either. But I did some more verification of this by doing some loss of function pharmacological studies. If I pharmacologically inhibit the tyrosine hydroxylase protein and transplant stem cells, the cells still elevate BDNF levels, but they do not elevate dopamine, and they don't improve dopamine-dependent behaviors. Similarly, if I transplant stem cells and concurrently pharmacologically inhibit the GLT-1 transporter, BDNF levels still rise with the stem cells, but glutamate regulation is not improved, and neither are glutamate-dependent behaviors. So these pathways do seem to be dependent on BDNF-related signaling. So then the question becomes, is BDNF sufficient? Can it do this on its own, or are there other factors that the stem cells are providing that are critical to the ability of BDNF to even help with these things? So to address this, I did one more study in these mice, which was our lab developed an adeno-associated virus carrying either M-cherry or M-cherry with BDNF so that we could deliver BDNF all on its own. And in the same timeline, I injected these animals in the striatum and tested the same behaviors 1 month later. And what I saw was that our virus gave us very good expression of BDNF in the striatum, and it was specific to neurons, which is where the synuclein is and where we were hoping to have an effect. And when I looked at behaviors, I saw that the M-cherry injected mice, which were our vehicle control mice in the study, still had faults on the beam traversal challenge, which is representative of both the motor tasks now. But when I injected BDNF, those foot faults were once again reduced. So BDNF alone seems to be able to improve motor function, at least in this task. However, when I looked at the cognitive tasks, BDNF alone was not sufficient to improve discrimination and preference for novelty over familiarity. So BDNF alone seems to be partially sufficient for improving these behaviors, but there clearly are other contributions from the cells themselves. So the conclusions from this mouse transplantation study were that these neural stem cells could improve behavioral impairment due to alpha-synuclein accumulation, that neural stem cell-derived BDNF is necessary, but BDNF alone is only partially sufficient for these benefits, and that neural stem cells improve dopamine and glutamate signaling in a BDNF-dependent manner. So, having characterized some of the benefits of these mouse neural stem cells, we then wanted to move on and see what human cells had to offer. Could human cells also achieve similar benefits in these mice? And this is a very important step between what happens in the lab at the bench and moving these therapies eventually to the clinic where they can actually help humans, which is the ultimate goal of doing all of this. And in order to transplant human cells into a mouse model, you face some challenges of the mouse immune system rejecting the human stem cells. So the adaptive immune system is made up of TB and natural killer cells, whose job it is to identify foreign objects such as human stem cells or bacteria and attack them. But that puts our human stem cells in danger and they can't help the mouse that way. So there are ways to get rid of these cells, and they involve immunosuppressant drugs. However, these drugs can have direct effects on alpha-synuclein, specifically enhancing its aggregation, which is the opposite of what we want to see. So what we did to protect our human stem cells is to eliminate these cells transgenically by crossing our alpha-synuclein mice with a commercially available RAG2 IL-2 R gamma double knockout mouse. So these mouse genetically just do not have these cells. So after backcrossing these mice for several generations and verifying that our transplanted cells could survive in them, we also verified that this version of the model, this immune-deficient synuclein mouse, also accumulates alpha-synuclein into inclusions, also develops similar motor and cognitive deficits. So feeling good about our model, we then moved forward to choose a cell type. And this part of my project was done in collaboration with Clive Svensson at Cedars-Sinai, whose lab derived and maintains these cells, and with Brian Shelley from that lab, who showed me how to use them. Now these cells are pretty cool for several reasons. One, because they also, like the mouse cells, prefer to become glial. They are also really close to entering clinical trials already for treating ALS. So they are GMP compatible, which means if they do the right thing in this study, they could eventually help patients with DLB as well in the relatively near future. So with these cells, I then performed a similar experiment to what we've seen with the mouse stem cell transplants. The difference here is that I added a 3-month time point as well, an extension of the time that the cells were in the brain, in order to see if they could have a lasting effect, which is important to figuring out if they can help humans and have a long-term benefit to humans. So after 1 month after transplantation, I tested our motor tasks once again, and I saw at the 1-month time point that our immune-deficient synuclein vehicle-treated mice had deficits both on the rotor rod and on our beam traversal challenge. And those were reversed by the human stem cell transplants at the 1 month time point. At the 3 month time point, they maintain that benefit. So the stem cells can rescue these motor behaviors by 1 month and maintain that recovery for up to 3 months. When we looked at our hippocampal and cortical cognitive behaviors, we saw a similar effect, a deficit in discrimination in our synuclein vehicle treated mice, which was elevated by neural stem cells both at 1 month and at the 3 month time points. So these human cells are just as cool as the mouse neural stem cells. They can do pretty much the same thing in this different model of the disease. So what are the cells doing in the brain? First, as I did before, I looked at the survival and migration of the cells and saw that at least by the 3 month time point, they had spread very nicely throughout the striatal region. I then needed to characterize what these cells were becoming. And we did that because these human cells do not naturally fluoresce green. They're human cells, and we didn't genetically modify them at all. So we co-labeled these human cells with either a cytoplasmic or a nuclear human-specific marker. And we're then able to identify several of the types of neurons they were starting to differentiate into. Instead of going through all of this one by one, I'm just going to summarize for you that the primary outcome that we saw in these cells is that they mostly express markers for glial early glial differentiation, such as vimentin or GFAP, as well as the mature glial marker S100 beta. In contrast, the early neuronal marker double portin is maintained between 1 and 3 months. And we also looked at the stem cell characteristics of these cells and saw a dramatic decrease in the progenitor marker nestin, and maintained low levels of Ki-67, which means a low proliferation rate is continuing for these cells. Importantly, they're not forming masses or tumors, and their differentiation is the primary outcome. So most of our cells are glial, just like I hoped, which led me to ask the question, are they also working through a BDNF-dependent mechanism just like the mouse neural stem cells did? I even predicted this would be the case, and I was very wrong. So, as you can see, not only is there not a loss of mature BDNF in our immune-deficient synuclein mice compared to controls, which in itself warrants further investigation because something else is going on there, the stem cells didn't elevate levels of BDNF at either 1 or 3 months. And an interesting explanation for this actually came out of RNA sequencing data that was published around the time that I found this result, showing that even though in the mouse neural stem cells, BDNF is expressed highly in astrocytes, glial cells, as we expected, and lower in neuronal cells, it's the opposite in human cells. Human cells express most of their BDNF in neurons and less of it in astrocytes and other glial cells. So our stem cells, which are mostly starting to become glial, are less likely to be producing BDNF. And that is an explanation for why these levels are lower. I was fascinated to find, however, that even though we weren't affecting BDNF, the stem cells still seem to be affecting regulation of dopamine and glutamate. So when I look once again at our phosphoepitopes for tyrosine hydroxylase, at the 1 month time point, even though this increase due to stem cells isn't significant yet, by the 3 month time point, it's really apparent and very significant. So the stem cells by the 3 month time point are able to improve dopamine regulation. When I looked at the GLT-1 transporter once again, we saw a similar thing, that the decrease in synucleinomide at 1 and 3 months was significantly elevated at both 1 month and 3 months post-transplantation. So even though they're not working through a BDNF-dependent mechanism, these human stem cells are still able to help regulate both of these neurotransmitter systems. So the big question becomes, are they perhaps affecting the alpha-synuclein protein? My hypothesis is that that's exactly what they're doing. That alpha-synuclein, as I said, is a synaptic terminal protein. It's messed up. It disrupts neurotransmitter signaling at the synapse. And all of these other confirmations in order to address this hypothesis need to be observed, which is a very difficult task and why I was not able to do so with the mouse transplantation studies. So for these human studies, there's my hypothesis. It's the same as before, that the stem cells would be able to reduce aggregated alpha-synuclein. I was able to work with our local protein chemists who face a similar problem in resolving and visualizing aggregates of the Huntington protein when they look at Huntington's disease. And so I was able to look at a few more of these aggregates than I was in the mouse. What I saw in these immunodeficient mice was when I looked at these Lewy body-like inclusions, once again, human alpha-synuclein, they're not changed at either 1 month or 3 months. So again, the stem cells are not affecting the inclusion number of this insoluble protein. But I was able to look at the insoluble forms of this protein spread out on a Western blot gel and saw a little bit different. What I saw was a little bit different. Looking at the human alpha-synuclein protein, I was once again only able to observe the monomer form, but this verified the insoluble alpha-synuclein in the monomeric form, although high in both our alpha-synuclein groups, was not reduced by stem cells at either 1 or 3 months. When I looked at the total alpha-synuclein, including mouse and human together, I was able to observe other aggregates of this protein, both a dimer and some high molecular weight proteins represented in a smear. But even though I was able to observe those other forms, what that told me is that the stem cells, again, were not having an effect on their expression. So what all of this is saying is that the human cells are not able to reduce or alter expression of several insoluble alpha-synuclein forms. But I was able to also look at the soluble forms of the protein. And when I did that, once again, some null data that the stem cells were not changing the levels of monomeric human synuclein in the soluble fraction at 1 month. And if I can remind you, I had the same null result when I transplanted mouse neural stem cells into my immune intact mice. But the difference in this study is that I had a 3 month time point. And when I looked at that 3 month time point, it became apparent that stem cells were significantly reducing soluble monomeric human alpha-synuclein after 3 months transplantation, which is cool. Like, you never see this. The culprit protein is never actually reduced by your therapy. It's very difficult to see, unless you come to Joseph's defense in 2 weeks. And then I'll show you something very much like this. And I verified that this was happening at the protein level, not at the gene level, by qPCR, showing that the mRNA levels of human alpha-synuclein were not affected by the stem cells. So this is a protein-specific phenomenon. When I looked at the total alpha-synuclein, which includes mouse, and actually mostly is representing the mouse protein, the elevations in synuclein are apparent in both synuclein-treated groups, or in both synuclein groups, at 1 and 3 months, and they're not reduced by stem cells at either point. And I love this result because it shows that the stem cells are having a specific effect on the human form of synuclein, which, as I said, is the form that's prone to aggregation and causing all these cellular problems. Mouse synuclein doesn't aggregate like that and doesn't tend to have these problems. So it's very neat that the human stem cells are targeting the human protein. My final assessment was to be able to use this oligomer-specific antibody, which sees specific conformations of aggregated alpha-synuclein in a soluble form, And I analyzed this by dot plot and was able to see that even though these forms were not changed at the 1 month time point, they were modestly but significantly decreased by human stem cells by 3 months. So the cells are having some effect on alpha-synuclein. We don't know how they're doing it yet. We know that they're doing it. So the conclusions from this human transplant study are that the human neural stem cells can also improve behavioral impairment and dysregulated signaling due to alpha-synuclein, and that they appear to be doing this at least in part by altering soluble alpha-synuclein forms. But I want to wrap up by doing sort of a side-by-side comparison of what I saw with the mouse transplantation and with the human transplantation, because there are similarities and differences. Striatal transplantation of both mouse and human cells improved motor and cognitive impairment. That was a universal finding to this study. Mouse neural stem cells and human cells improved dopamine and glutamate signaling, but mouse cells seem to be doing this through a BDNF-dependent mechanism, and human cells seem to be doing it through a totally different mechanism, which I have not figured out yet. Finally, the human cells are likely improving this behavior through regulating dopamine and glutamate signaling by altering alpha-synuclein. And mouse cells may or may not actually be able to do this as well. In my mouse study, I only looked at the 1 month time point after transplantation. And if I had looked at 3 months down the line, maybe I would have seen a similar effect to what the human cells were able to achieve. But someone else should do that experiment. I have been told that the best scientific experiments raise more questions than they answer, and that has certainly been the case with my dissertation. There are many remaining questions, starting with what's happening to the RNA. There are a lot of unanswered questions about the mechanisms that are activated by neural stem cells and affecting alpha-synuclein that can easily be defined by looking at the RNA. And some of that is actually happening in our lab already, thanks to the lovely Jacqueline Caesar, who is here today, who did her master's working with me and extracted a whole bunch of RNA from 7 different regions of the brain that we can now look at and try to figure out how stem cells in the striatum are affecting all of those regions. And Dr. Anita Lakatos, who is doing this magical network-wide analysis that I don't understand, of comparing what's going on at the transcriptional level for multiple different systems. And actually, that's a paper that will hopefully be coming out soon. Also, the alpha-synuclein oligomer profiling. Despite all this work that Joseph and I did together, we were still only able to look at a few different kinds of this alpha-synuclein conformers and what's happening to them. So there are other assays and other ways that we can develop the assays that we've already worked on to try to figure out what is happening with all these different forms of alpha-synuclein and which ones are real and which ones are not, and that's difficult to determine as well. And then, so I've showed you that stem cells are reducing alpha-synuclein, but again, those mechanisms remain mysterious. They are likely happening through regulation of autophagy or stimulation of the ubiquitin proteasome system. And those are potential mechanisms that need to be fleshed out. When I was talking about dopamine and glutamate, I'm talking about them basically in terms of transporters, receptors, and enzymes, but I'm never talking about specifically the neurotransmitter. But there are ways that you can do that by doing microdialysis or voltammetry, a functional analysis of what those actual transmitters are doing at the synapse and how stem cells and alpha-synuclein might be affecting them. And finally, the immune response profiling. There is obviously a role of the immune system here because I have differences between my mice, our immune deficient and immune intact mice. And there are also very likely a role of the way the immune system is reacting to the stem cell transplantation that's important to their ability to rescue the behaviors in this mice. So that's my long-winded future directions, none of which I plan to do yet. So I'd like to close by thanking everybody on my team, which involves this very recent lab picture that we finally got the other day. And Maria is not here because she just gave birth to a beautiful baby boy. Jack is here today. I can't thank everyone, everyone in this room, I think, has been a very big part of my process here over the last 5 years, my development as a scientist and as a human being. And I can't say enough about the wonderful relationships that I've had and that everyone means to me in my development. Everyone in our lab, Jack, Sam, and Wes, and Edsel, my brothers in science. have just been tremendous resources in terms of bouncing off ideas and putting in new ideas where I couldn't find them myself. And I love you guys tremendously and think you know that. And my committee advisors, Marcelo and Joan, who are just forces of nature in this business and have rescued me so many times from myself through trying to identify the right direction to go with my research and with my career. And other advisors, Leslie and Peter, and I don't see Kim maybe, but and Brian, just all the advice I've received from my mentors has been taken and has meant a lot to me. And then there's this guy.
Yeah.
I changed my shirt. who is an inspiration both as a personality and a scientist. And Matt invested so much in me early on, sending me to international conferences, workshops, I guess hoping that I would come back a little wiser. And I hope that has been worth it. It certainly has to me. So thank you for letting me grow up as a scientist in your lab. I can still talk, this is good. My students, my Bio99s who have rotated through the lab are phenomenal human beings, two of whom are already in med school and three of whom are on their way to big, wonderful achievements. They have humbled me and taught me every day how to be a better scientist and a leader and a mentor. So I only see you, Keanu, so thank you. For what you have meant to my scientific development. The folks with whom I have taught, we have been through so much together, working on various projects and navigating the world of teaching, and your friendships mean the world to me as well. The people who I've worked with at Remind and who have helped me develop as a scientific communicator and reach out to other people and be able to inspire them about science the same way I am inspired. The people who I've worked with, Kelly Sharp is phenomenal, and Rachel Green, Aaron, Monica, Sam, it's just, these people are phenomenal colleagues, and I'm so fortunate to have worked with all of you. And my friends, who are mostly all of you all also, my friends who have been so supportive, the ones who are not in the program and who are, and who have dealt with my personality changes, and again, just, helped me navigate my way through everything. My family, I'm so fortunate to have extended family in the area. These are my cousins, aunts, and uncles, some of whom are here. And my parents, my siblings, have been so supportive. So this is what I've been up to for the last 5 years and what I've been struggling with or excited about. My dogs, who are so important to surviving this. This is my mentor, my pre-grad school mentor, Charlie Meschel, who's a researcher up at Oregon Health and Sciences University, who taught me how to observe myself as a scientist, who taught me to not take myself too seriously, something about which he reminded me yet again last night before I did this talk, because he knows that I need constant reminding. He's the reason, well, he and my parents pretty much are the reasons that I made it into graduate school at all. And then there's this guy. I'm doing really well. I didn't think I'd be able to speak at this point, so this message is for you. Some of you know Charlie and know what a just phenomenal human being he is and how supportive he's been of me and just how pleasant and wonderful his spirit is. So thank you for sticking with me. That's it. Science. Back to science.
Talk your work, the neural stem cells, they mostly differentiated into glia.
Mm-hmm.
But then when you did the viral vector experiments,
mm-hmm.
You said they were expressing the BDNF in neurons. So,
right.
So that was different.
Mm-hmm.
And although it seems less important now because in the second part of the experiment, they did the human stem cells didn't express BDNF.
Yeah, but why did we target
Why did
neurons?
You target neurons and did they did you look at the mature forms of the BDNF?
Yes. So all the protein that we looked at was that I showed you was the matured BDNF. There were no changes in the proform of the protein. And when we looked at qPCR, there were also not significant changes at the mRNA level. So most of this seems to be happening at the protein level with maturation of BDNF, also which needs to be more elucidated. But the reason we targeted neurons with BDNF virus and not glial cells was because the alpha-synuclein is a neuronal protein, and it's overexpressed in the neurons. That's where we thought it was causing the problems, and that's what we wanted BDNF to target. The glial cells produce lots of high levels of BDNF, but that BDNF is secreted. It functions as a secreted protein that's taken up by other cells. And so we were hoping that the BDNF produced by the glial cells was uptaken by those neurons as well. So the virus, we just went straight for it and overexpressed it in the neurons. Yes, Andrea?
Yeah, a very nice presentation. But I'm sort of following up on that, and maybe you said this already and I just missed it, but was the level of BDNF in your brain areas when you virally transfected in that way versus putting in red stencils, were the levels the same?
No. So they're expressed at much higher levels by the virus. And I did some time course and concentration studies and tried to get that expression down to as close to the stem cells as we could. But the fact that the viral BDNF was even observable by immunohistochemistry, it was there at higher levels than the just BDNF was. Joseph?
Did you look at like pre- and post-synaptic markers to see, kind of talk
I
about
did.
The elucidate
so, yeah, so this is a really fascinating and frustrating thing, is that at the protein level, synaptic markers like post-synaptic PS195, PSD95, thank you, and synaptophysin, synaptotagmin, all those presynaptic markers, they're not altered at the protein level. And the analysis that Anita's working on with our network transcriptional studies is also indicating there's not changes in those markers. So it may be an activity-related thing, the way that synuclein is interacting with these other synaptic proteins, but I'm not sure what's going on there. It's pretty perplexing.
So was your protein stuff lessons done across the whole brain, or would you use subzone specific?
No, except for the alpha-synuclein I showed you in the very beginning, it was all microdissected striatum, because we were focusing on what was happening where the stem cells were. There is actually, I did look at other microdissected regions as well. Not as much going on there with BDNF or with other markers like glutamate or dopamine, but there's things happening in other regions of the brain as well. They're just different pathways.
Yeah. Beautiful work, Natalie. So one question. In the knockout BDNF versus sort of wild BDNF cells that you used in the first part of your study,
yeah.
You may have said it, I could miss it. Did you actually characterize the differentiation profile of those in vitro or in vivo?
I did, yes, in vivo. So they differentiate a little more slowly than the mouse neural stem cells do.
You get the same proportions of neurons on
yes.
those astrocytes?
Yes. Same proportions, that just come along a little slower. Here.
Looking at your conclusions then, Natalie, it kind of illustrates the difficulty of doing biology.
Yes.
You can end on that note.
In terms of the human cells, thinking of where one might go forward with that, that presumably is a cell line that is a finite lifespan.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see batch-to-batch variations? When you did the studies of the mouse neural stem cells,
mm-hmm.
did you use different batches and see the same results with each batch?
Yes, so I used this for the mouse stem cell studies. I used the same passage for all the cells from originally the same batch, but they're from different vials for each of the knockout study, pharmacological studies. I got similar survival in all of those for the mouse. For the human cells, I have not personally done a lot of work with them because they're Clive cells and I'm kind of restricted as to what I could do. But in terms of in vivo survival, I had two different batches for the human studies, and they survived at about the same rate. Their viability was very similar prior to and after, like through the transplantation surgeries. I did not do a comparison between the overall survival numbers of human and mouse cells.
In your viral vector, when you're overexpressing BDNF, did it have a leader sequence for secretion?
No. Yes.
No.
It was the full length form. It was the full length form of BDNF, but it didn't include the secretion signal. So yes, there are also a couple different reasons other than the overexpression or just BDNF alone why BDNF was not able to rescue behavior as much as the cells. Even though the antibody was able to identify it, which means it was likely being transcribed properly, translated properly, there could be problems with how it's post-translationally modified, problems with how it's actually being active in the cell. So that was one of the reasons why I went forward with the titer that I did, is to provide more of it to try to compensate for some of that. Yes?
Does your model have documented synaptic release probability changes, and if so, is there other plans to see if one of your therapies alters neuronal function specifically release probability or synapse number? Synapse number. I was wondering if there was any
The number of synapses.
Yeah, if there was any chance that if you're
I can't recall any actual total counts of quantification of the number of synapses being changed. The formation of the synapses is altered in these mice. And in terms of release, dopamine release in the striatum has been documented and it's decreased. But yes, there are definitely ways to look at that in this model, that including microdialysis and voltammetry and techniques for number of vesicle release, which I'm not familiar with. I'm not an electrophysiologist. Peter.
So one of the kind of obvious experiments that seems to come out of this study, if you believe the BDNF knockdowns and the interpretation of it, is that why not give them more BDNF and just make the cell use less of it?
Yes.
Did you or anyone else try to do something like that?
We talked about it, yes. So we talked about trying to make Clive cells actually secrete BDNF at high levels. We didn't get there because the wild type cells were doing such a great job on their own. But yes, that can be done. And I did a pilot study with GDNF secreting human stem cells that also performed similarly to the wild type cells. Yes?
BDNF knockdown cells, is there any difference in long-term survival? Have you looked at that?
So the long-term survival doesn't seem to be affected. The short-term survival is a little bit, the rates are a little bit lower than the normal neural stem cells, but they recover that over time if you let them sit in the dish long enough and can survive at the same rates after they surpass and start replicating again from that initial time point.
Okay, well, thank you. Take a few minutes with Natalie's committee, but I welcome all of you to come out to the balcony there. We'll be having a short little celebration. A few minutes.
Hopefully.
I'll see you. Yeah, perfect. I think she gets it from my.